our way, that you would be mindful of us. What do you see that's worth looking our way? That we never should be. Sweet release from the grips of these chains. Like hinges straining from the weight, my heart can no longer keep from every heart that is broken. our hearts will cry, these bones will say, great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will say, our hearts will cry, these bones will say, great are you, Lord. And your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we lost or saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of your great name. The enemy, he has to leave at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. All the weak find their strength at the sound of your great name. Sound of your great name. The fatherless find their rest at the sound of your great name. The sick are healed, the dead are raised at the sound of your great. Worthy is the Lamb that lifted up, and all the world will praise the name of Jesus. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, the Son of God and man. You are high and lifted up, and all the world side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. By your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
Your word tells us, Lord, it hasn't even entered into the heart of man, which you have prepared for us. And as vivid as our imaginations are in which you've created us to be, the things that you have, well, Paul said they were unspeakable. To behold in eternity around your throne, your character, your nature, who you are, to see it and like now through a glass dimly, Lord, to see it face to face. Not only does that produce hope and joy in our hearts and the expectation of soon, very soon, we'll be with the King, it reminds us of now of the temporary nature and the limitations of what we have walking and breathing this air. And Lord, we pray that you this morning, as we open your word, will quicken our hearts to a glimpse of your glory. You'll move us closer to your character, to your nature, that we'll behold in wonderment to the limitations that we have, a greater understanding of you. And we look to the Spirit of God to do that work this morning. We pray that you would move us closer to you. And we thank you in advance, in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning. We will be in 2 Peter. 2 Peter, starting in chapter 2. We'll only be looking at the first three verses, and actually only really one verse of that. Setting up this passage as you turn there, Peter had been talking to this group or writing to a group of Christians who were so hungry to grow in the Lord that made them susceptible to false teaching. He has outlined for them that though the Gnostics, though the people who are claiming to have new information, new experiences, he has already proclaimed to them that he had the greatest experience, and that is on the Mount of Transfiguration when he heard the Lord say, "This is my son in whom I'm well pleased." But even with that, as already mentioned, 6 months later, he falls while to a servant girl in the trial of Jesus and denies the Lord. Even with that great experience, even with that encounter, it's hard for us to even imagine something like that. I don't know if there's any analogy that I can come up with that would drive it home as much. Suppose that you met someone that you've longed to meet your whole life. You spend time knowing them, knowing their character, knowing their attributes, knowing who they are, and then having that amazing experience only to deny that you even met them. Only moments later. And even that just pales in it to me. But that is Peter's testimony. And then he talked about the fact that as great as that encounter was, there was something that consistently did have its work in him, and that is the Word of God. And so when you hear people, maybe we've said this ourselves, that man, if I could have just seen Jesus, I could have just walked when he walked, I would be so much easier. Take it from Peter, it's not. You have the Word of God by the Spirit of God on a regular basis. He was encouraging these readers to not fall into the concept that new is always better, that we can have new encounters and new experiences and new information, and all that will garner clarity. He says, no, it doesn't. What gets us clarity is when we delve into the Word of God by the Spirit of God, asking the Word of God and the supernatural nature of the Word of God. I don't know if you ever thought about the time that you're in your Bibles. And this isn't to make it that you should worship your Bibles. But the time that you're in your Bibles and you've prayed, your heart is open to hearing from the Word of God by the Spirit of God. The time that you're having, there's a holy moment. You're having an encounter with the living God, the divine inspiration of Scripture, the uniqueness of the Word of God. It's a shame. It's no wonder why Satan has attacked it so much, but it's a shame that so many Christians have gone away from reading their Bibles and so many churches aren't teaching it. It is no doubt, whether they recognize it or not, they have been a tool in the tool belt of the enemy to diminish the church and to weaken the Christian. We need to be consistent in the Word. We need to go through the Bibles. And I know there's a lot of Bible reading programs out there. You can read through the Bible in a year. You can, you know, all the different things that you can do. You can get devotionals. I'm not anti-anything. Anything that drives you to the Word. I get the questions from people sometimes, oh, which translation is the best translation? And I always say this, the one you're reading. I'm not a big certain translation guy. But to be honest with you, if you take a look at all the different translations, there's no major doctrines changed in any of them. So if you can better understand, better have an encounter with the Lord through reading one translation above another, then go for it. I tease Dale a time and do Nearly Inspired Version, the NIV or something. But I mean that all tongue-in-cheek. I read out of the New King James Version because, honestly, I have been doing it for close to 40 years, and actually it started out with the NIV, no offense, Dale, but I liked it, and I bought my wife a Bible, gosh, you know, 40 after became Christians, and she wanted the one that the pastor was teaching through, which is the New King James, and I gave it to her, and I kept on picking up and reading it, and I said, well, why am I reading an NIV when I prefer reading out of this one? So that's how I got involved in it. So you probably having your own encounters that way. So get into the Word. Now as we get into this, this is a very negative. It's actually chapter 2 is kind of a downer. You know, he speaks of false teaching in such a way that is probably, without a doubt, it's the darkest chapter in the letter section that we're looking at. It's very negative. A lot of people, commentators, will just skip over chapter 2. But it's here in the text. And I think what Peter does here is that to illustrate how bright the light you have of the Word of God through the Spirit of God, you can only comprehend the lightness if you see some darkness. The contrast here of what he says. He says, starting in chapter 2, verse 1, but there were also false prophets among the people, even as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in the destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring on them swift destruction, and many will follow their destructive ways, because of whom the way of truth will be blasphemed. By covetousness, they will exploit you with deceptive words. For a long time, their judgment has not been idle, and destruction does not slumber. That's just the beginning of just such a warm and fuzzy passage. It's a dark passage, but notice several things before we break apart all of this. He's already outlined for us, and we went through this for a couple weeks, looking at prophecy. He gave us a super outline. So kind of looking at this, I had to piece it together a bit, but he kind of gives us an outline of what false teachers are as well. But I want you to notice here, he brings up the worst case scenario of what these false teachers eventually, and I think it's a slippery slope. I think what Peter's talking about, he says, even there will be false teachers among you who secretly bring destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them. And you see, they start off with something, but eventually they continue on false teaching. Anything that diminishes the person and work of Christ will eventually slide into a canister of garbage that will even deny Jesus Christ. Somebody doesn't start off with that, is what Peter's trying to say. It's progressive in nature, just like the Word of God was progressive and how it could communicate you one way and eventually lead you closer. False teaching is progressive too. It would eventually slide all the way down into something that you never would have started out with. You always hear somebody who believes something so weird, so strange. How did they get there? Did they just wake up and I think I'll believe, you know, and they just say it? No, they don't. They start off with diminishing the person and work of Christ and move on to something else. And remember, too, I want you to recognize that this letter was written to the church. This isn't talking about false, weird concepts in the world system. We're familiar with that. But this is directed to Christians and to the church. Satan, when he lost on Calvary, he entered through the church through the back door and into the pulpit. We need to be very careful.
Quiet my soul, remember, redemption's hill where your blood was spilled for my ransom, and everything I once had. Came flesh, bore my sin and death. Now you're risen, and everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me. Lead me to your heart. To your heart. Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing. But am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not where I am. lost in the current of a raging sea. I have this blessed assurance holding me. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not where I belong. Take this world and give me Jesus. This is not where I disciples asked you, how do we pray, Lord God? Even you said, our Father who art in heaven, holy is your name, Lord God. That's the first thing that we are supposed to pray, first thing we're supposed to think of, first thing that we're supposed to acknowledge before anything else, Lord, is the holiness, your holiness. And Father God, we just I thank you again for the word today, Lord God, that help us to have that first and foremost in our minds, Lord. When we pray to you, when we speak to others, Lord God, that we acknowledge who you are, and not just... We know that your love and your mercy and your forgiveness and your mercies are new every morning, Lord God. We know all of that, Lord, but we do tend to forget about how holy and right and just you are, Lord. So we just we thank you for all that you are, and we ask that you would continue to grow us deeper in you. Thank you, in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.